Hi there, well I've just returned from Christchurch and today we announced further details on our home insulation package, which is both a home insulation and heating package. We think it'll affect about 180,000 households or around 500,000 New Zealanders over the next 4 years. It'll be a very important program for improving the health outcomes for a lot of New Zealanders. We know that they're getting sick, having time off school or off work, simply because their homes are cold and damp. There's been quite a lot of studies undertaken showing that your average house should be heated to about 18 degrees or 20 degrees if you're a little bit older. A lot of New Zealand homes are being heated under 16 degrees and in cold parts of the home as low as zero. So for New Zealanders that want to access this package, they'll be able to get a total of up to about $1,800. About $1,300 for the insulation package, $500 for the heating, and potentially up to $3,000 if they're a lower income New Zealander. There's going to be lots of options to work with providers like the banks, for instance, who are going to waive fees and will put it onto your mortgage for the additional amount over and above the subsidy. And I think it'd be a tremendous opportunity not only to insulate your home. There's no, for instance, cap on income, which has been a feature of some of the historic type of schemes that we've run. So any New Zealander can apply with a house built before the year 2000. Post then, of course, the regulations changed and those houses will be properly insulated. Around about 900,000 New Zealand homes fit within this potential category. So this is a big step forward. It was a huge initiative in the budget. It was $323 million of expenditure over the next 4 years. So I encourage you to seek out more information, either on EECA's website or on the Beehive website or our own website, to get in touch with the relevant providers and to consider insulating and heating your home. I think that'll make a tremendous difference.
Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the launch of the government's home insulation and clean heat program. Can I acknowledge the Prime Minister who is joining us this morning and will make the appropriate announcements and tell us what the name of the program is going to be. Janet Simons is also present. The Green Party through Janet have been very much part of the development of this program. I want to acknowledge the mayors who are here. I know that Bob Parker is here, Lawrence Yule is here, Sakiri Burke is here, the chair of the Regional Council. I'm sure there may be others. I know there are councillors in the room as well. Can I welcome all those who are providers, all those from the finance sector who are part of the program, and the many others who have a particular interest in this particular program. 30 years ago, I was a builder working on building sites, and many of the houses that will benefit from this were houses that I worked on. I just never knew that it would take 30 years in a cabinet seat to get the job done. But it will be, I think, great progress for those who are going to benefit from the program. The Prime Minister has been involved from the start in pushing this program. It was his initiative that involved the Green Party, and we think it's a fine example of how MEP can work constructively and that a way of showing that politicians can work periodically together for the benefit of the people that they represent. I want to say coming to Christchurch for the launch is appropriate because this is a city that has done a lot over the last couple of decades to improve air quality and also to support home insulation. While the ECAN does get a bit of a bad rap at times, can I say that they have been leaders in this regard and should be acknowledged. I also want to congratulate the people from the Community Energy Action Trust, who are funded by ECA and have had that funding since 1994. They've completed 14,000 homes locally. One of those homes is my own. Is my electric office. So I just want to make it clear that I did pay full commercial rates for that installation. Can I, in that regard, acknowledge Mike McChesney and Del Small, who both worked for that organisation right from the start, and I know of their great passion for this particular sort of work. EECA will be delivering the program. If Can I acknowledge the presence here this morning of Roger Sutton, the Chairman of ICA, Michael Underhill, the Chief Executive, and a number of his staff who are present. When the Prime Minister has spoken, Ms. Fitzsimons will make a few comments, and then after lunch, the ICA team will be available to answer the detailed questions that I know some of you will want to ask. So without any further ado, can I invite the Prime Minister to come forward and to tell us a little bit more about the scheme.
Gerry, thanks very much. It's interesting to hear Gerry saying his former life in the building industry, and it's very well known. He's very practical bloke, actually. Gerry and I've gone down to his office sometimes. He's, you know, these drawings and pictures, and he's working out how things fit together. And just to let you know, I am diametrically opposite in that regard to Gerry. To put in perspective, or the words of my mother, she once said to me, "Son, there are two types of people in the world, doers and payers, and you are definitely a payer." So don't ask me to go and carry out the installation, but I think I can sort of academically work out why it's such a good idea. Bob, it's great to be back in your city, and Joe, it's lovely to see you again. It's great to be here last Thursday night. That we had a very positive time here talking about the economy and the issues that we face. Lawrence, wherever you are, somewhere around Blunt, there you go. Great to see you, and local government, all the work that you're doing. So can I acknowledge everyone that's in the room, in particular also my parliamentary colleagues, Nikki, Gerry and Jeanette. I'll have a few more words to say in a moment. But thank you all for coming today here to officially launch Warm Up New Zealand Heat Smart, the government's insulation and energy efficiency heating program. It's a very exciting day because we are celebrating the start of something big. I would like to thank the Minister for Energy and Resources, Gerry Brownlee, for his role in leading this initiative. And as Gerry pointed out, he's had previous experience in the building industry. So he's not just a minister sitting around dreaming up policies. He actually knows how all of this works. I would also like to acknowledge Jeanette. Jeanette has, as all you, everyone will know, has stood down from the co-leadership of the Green Party, and I think is leaving Parliament at the end of this parliamentary term. But she's worked hard and fought very hard for the issues that she cares passionately about. One of those is about making sure that New Zealand homes are warmer and better insulated, because she knows and has understood for a long time the benefits of that. And Jeanette, I know that when you finally do leave Parliament, you'll be able to look back and take a lot of credit for the fact that literally tens of thousands of New Zealanders will be a lot warmer and be in better conditions, which will deliver better health and social outcomes. So we want to wish you all the very best for that. And thank you for being part of it. I will make just one comment in that regard. And that is, when you become Prime Minister, the Department of Prime Minister and Cabinet actually gives you a briefing, comes to talk to you about the issues that they think are really crucially important. So the argument is, these are the things that we think that you should focus on. You may be interested to know that right up at the top of the list is heating homes. So it's heating and insulating homes. And the reason for that is they work out the social and health outcomes that can be achieved. And for a lot of young New Zealanders in particular, they're not attending school because they're sick, growing up in conditions which are seeing them back in hospital. And today we're about to embark on changing that. For what it's worth, by the way, the other thing that's right at the top of the list for DVMC is making sure that every child gets into early childhood education. And again, that's been a focus of attention of the government, but not one that we're here to talk about today. So in the budget, we allocated $323 million over 4 years towards insulation and clean heating. That is a significant investment at a time when we all know there is not a lot of money around. The government will provide grants of up to $1,800 for ceiling and underfloor insulation and a clean heating device for houses built before the year 2000. That investment will make a big difference to New Zealanders up and down the country. There is a lot of work to be done. Around 900,000 of New Zealand homes are inadequately insulated. That is more than half of the total number of houses in this country. When a house is not insulated properly, it is more difficult and more costly to heat is more likely to remain cold and damp. The World Health Organization's had quite a lot to say about that. It recommends a minimum indoor temperature of 18 degrees for healthy people and 20 degrees for those who are sick or with disabilities and for the very young or very old. But the average living room temperature of a New Zealand home is just less than 16 degrees in winter, and in cold areas, indoor temperatures can get as low as 0 degrees. This clearly has an impact on people's health and well-being. Coldness and dampness make things worse for those with respiratory conditions, leading to more doctor's visits and admissions to hospital. That costs our health system an awful lot of money, and it means more days off work or school, causing a burden for employers and families. What's more, it's just plain miserable to have to spend time in a cold home. It causes unhappiness and stress for families and individuals. And it's often the elderly and sick who suffer the most because they spend a lot of time at home. Efforts to heat our homes go a lot further if we know that heat is not going to escape out of the roof immediately or through the floor or out through gaps in the doors and windows. So that's why insulation is so important. It keeps the heat in, makes it cost effective to properly heat our homes, and makes them healthy and dry. But insulation by itself won't make us warm. Heating is the next important component. Unfortunately, many New Zealand homes have relatively inefficient forms of heating, like open fires, electric heaters that can be expensive to run, and unflued gas heaters that can create dampness and give off harmful gases. So we are faced with an enormous number of uninsulated, poorly heated homes, and it is a serious problem. Various programs to insulate and heat New Zealand homes have been in place for more than a decade, but really have only scratched the surface. When the size of the problem is close to 1 million houses, you need to knock off more than 10 or 15,000 homes a year, which is currently what's happening. That is why we're putting in place a program that will run for at least 4 years and will insulate more than 180,000 homes in that time. So what does 180,000 homes look like? Well, 180,000 homes is the total number of houses in the Canterbury region, roughly speaking. 180,000 homes is the total number of all the houses in the South Island outside Canterbury. 180,000 homes is the number of private homes built over the last 12 years in New Zealand. So it's a very significant number. Of course, in terms of the number of people living in those houses, the number is actually a lot higher. It's roughly 500,000 people living in those 180,000 homes. So that is 500,000 people who will benefit from warmer, drier homes. To picture those people, think about this rugby stadium full of rugby fans for the Rugby World Cup. You only have to wait about 2 years for that. And it's good to see the stadiums doing so well, but all on hand. And the John Key Stadium, I thought, was looking quite nice, actually. So it's the Gerry Brownlee Stadium, that's right. I shouldn't rush into those names quite so early. So think about the stadium. It's going to house 43,000 people when it's full. So picture this stadium 11 times over. That is the number of people we are talking about. This then is a program that will make a difference to a very sizable chunk of New Zealanders, an eighth of the New Zealand population, to put it in perspective. Let's talk about the health benefits associated with this program. It is a fact that 1,600 people, more people die each winter than in summer. Researchers at the Housing and Health Research Program at the University of Otago in Wellington think that this is largely due to poor houses not protecting us from the cold, wet weather. Warm houses lower the risk of being ill and depressed. So insulating houses has been shown to make homes warmer and prevent illness. If 180,000 houses will be insulated under the current scheme and around 500,000 people will benefit from improved living conditions, then Otago University health researchers estimate that this program will have the following benefits. Firstly, it will mean approximately 72,000 days more at school during the winter months, or 373 more child years of education. Second thing is there could be up to a 33% fewer respiratory admissions for people with pre-existing respiratory conditions. Given the cost of the average night in hospital is $950, you can see that this makes sense even on a purely practical financial basis. And then there's the work that will be created. Over 4 years, we expect to see 33 square kilometres of insulation laid under the floor and in the ceilings of New Zealand homes. Given we are in a sports stadium, once again, let's use this analogy. 33 square kilometres is the equivalent of 4,000 rugby fields. Or if we took the pieces of insulation and laid them end to end, they would stretch for 36,000 kilometres, almost enough to stretch right around the Earth. Fitting that much insulation is a massive undertaking that will create an industry for hundreds of New Zealanders. It's work for those people in the factories making the insulation. It's the backroom staff making sure it goes right to the right place and sending out the right invoices. It's the van driver delivering the insulation. It's the service providers coordinating with the customers. It's the teams and teams of people laying the insulation. One of the things we as a government were determined to do with this program is to make it simple for customers to understand and access. That's why we've made the criteria as straightforward as possible. All houses built before the year 2000 qualify for the consideration. There is no income gap or means testing. Income testing has prevented thousands of New Zealanders making use of insulation funding programs up until now. The fact that they are now eager to get involved shows that upfront capital costs have been a barrier and that government assistance will make a difference. What's more, insulating homes has a national benefit even if the householder is comparatively well off. There are benefits from reduced load on the electricity grid and from job creation. We're all winners, no matter who gets their house improved. The emphasis in this scheme is on insulation. Proper insulation in the ceiling and underfloor must be in place before we'll give a grant for heating, and the heating device must be an approved log burner or wood pellet burner, a flue gas heater or a heat pump with an Energy Star rating. I am excited about the prospects of so many New Zealanders getting a tangible benefit from this program. And it's clear New Zealanders are excited about it too. I know that there have been a huge number of inquiries to ICA and to service providers about getting involved in the scheme, and that's great to hear. It highlights just how big the demand for the scheme will be. In the past 18 years, around 60,000 homes have been insulated. 60,000 homes in 18 years. We aim to treble that figure in less than a quarter of the time. The 1st of July is when the program starts. We've been careful to phase in our work program. In the coming financial year, we set a moderate goal to retrofit 27,000 homes, building up to 60,000 per annum in just 4 years. We start with around 30 existing service providers who will continue in the next 3 months in the new program until the new service providers come on board. And from today, the application process starts to take on board those additional service providers. I know that now, in the middle of winter, New Zealanders are focused on keeping warm and they are keen to improve their homes to make them warmer. We are working through ICA and the industry to deliver the scheme. On that note, I would like to address those in the audience today who are service providers, insulation manufacturers, installers, suppliers of log burners, pellet burners, gas heaters and heat pumps. You have some you have opportunity and some hard work ahead of you. Sounds like the instructions they give me at work as well. We, the government, can provide the money to stimulate the market, but it's up to you really to take this opportunity and make it work so we get good outcomes for New Zealanders. I'm absolutely convinced you're up for that challenge. One of the important features of this program is that it is designed to work in partnership with a range of product suppliers, installers, retailers, community groups, finance organisations and local government in order to offer a funding opportunity through as many channels as possible. Also in the audience today are representatives from the major banks. I'm very happy to announce today that all of the major banks, Kiwi Bank, ASB, BNZ, ANZ National and Westpac have agreed to participate in the program to allow customers approved under this program to add the remaining costs of their home insulation and heating to their mortgage. The banks have all signalled they are prepared to waive the administration fees for energy efficiency mortgage top-ups. So I applaud them for getting on board and for helping us get this opportunity out to as many New Zealanders as possible. Likewise, I'm thrilled to hear that a number of the councils have expressed interest in getting involved. Councils such as Environment Canterbury and Nelson City Councils are already running successful schemes that enable insulation and clean heating to be retrofitted. A range of other councils are taking part in a pilot scheme working through the technical and administrative processes to make this happen in their regions. One of the sectors of society most affected by respiratory disease, such as asthma, is Māori. A recent study, survey by Massey University's Centre for Public Health Research found that nearly a third of Māori children reported asthma symptoms compared to one in five for Pākehā children. For that reason, I'm very pleased to hear that iwi groups are already taking a very keen interest in this program. Not only are they looking at ways of providing top-up funding and other finance arrangements to make it easier for their communities to access insulation and heating, they are considering ways of using the scheme to build up useful trade skills and to provide employment. So we have the makings of a really comprehensive program that will offer a broad range of ways for New Zealanders to insulate their homes and add a heating component that is clean and cheap to run. Ladies and gentlemen, on July the 1st, the scheme will start. We've set our goals on the number of homes we will retrofit. The 180,000 homes over 4 years is a challenge, but it's a challenge we welcome and we embrace. Today is an important day. The program will benefit as many as 500,000 New Zealanders who will live in homes that are warmer and drier. It will improve their health, it will improve energy efficiency, and it will create jobs. It's a smart, practical program, and the government is proud to deliver Warm Up New Zealand, Heat Smart. Thank you very much.